I have had many requests to discuss vitamin K2, and so in this video, we will be answering the following questions. What does vitamin K do, and what is its role in the body? Who is at risk for a vitamin K deficiency? What are the signs and symptoms of a vitamin K deficiency? What are the dietary sources of vitamin K? And can vitamin K supplements interact with medications? If you stick with me till the end, I will show you a very recent study on vitamin K2 and its role in calcification and aortic stenosis that had some very interesting findings. Before we continue, I'd like to remind you that this video is not a replacement for medical advice. Please do not make any changes to your diet or medications without speaking to your healthcare provider first. There is increasing evidence that in some cases, our Western diet and the way that our food is produced may be leaving us more prone to different nutritional deficiencies. It is true that maintaining a diet that is complete with whole foods that you can cook and prepare yourself is ideal. However, this is not always the case, and this is not always the situation. We know that vitamins are essential nutrients. These nutrients are essential to maintain life and maintain many of the chemical reactions that our body needs to produce different life-sustaining proteins, for example. It is important to remember that vitamins are divided into those that are fat-soluble and those that are water-soluble. The fat-soluble vitamins include vitamins A, D, E, and K. And so vitamin K is the vitamin that we will be focusing on, this being a fat-soluble vitamin. It might be easy to confuse vitamin K with an element called potassium. These are two very different components. Vitamin K is an organic compound, whereas potassium, represented by K on the periodic table, is an inorganic element. So it's important to make this distinction before we go any further. So what does vitamin K do, and what is it good for? The original term for vitamin K comes from the German word coagulation, meaning the body's ability to clot or to prevent a hemorrhage. Newborn babies in particular are at higher risk for a vitamin K deficiency. And this is why when babies are born, they are quickly given a vitamin K injection in order to help prevent any tragic outcomes from hemorrhaging due to a vitamin K deficiency. It is important to note that our body does not store up large quantities of vitamin K, and the quantities of vitamin K that it does store, it seems to use quite rapidly. So we do need to acquire vitamin K either from our diet or from supplementation. When we speak of vitamin K, we are referring to a group of vitamins that are necessary cofactors for the production of many different substances and proteins in the body. These proteins are essential for maintaining adequate coagulation in the body, as well as normal levels of calcium. Since vitamin K was discovered, we have learned that it plays a very important role in disease states like osteoporosis, vascular calcification, osteoarthritis, cancer, and even cognition. Vitamins that are part of the group of vitamin K vitamins include vitamin K1, phylloquinone, vitamin K2, menaquinone, which can be produced by gut bacteria, and the little known or lesser known vitamin K3, which is a synthetic vitamin that is currently being studied for different cancer treatments and is currently not available to the public. Vitamin K2, known as menaquinone 4 and menaquinone 7, are vitamins that are essential for the process of coagulation, in particular for the formation of the protein prothrombin. Prothrombin is a protein in the body that gets converted to thrombin when you, say, cut yourself, and this helps to aid in the formation of a blood clot. Without these important proteins like prothrombin and thrombin, you would not be able to form the clots that are necessary to help prevent bleeding in different places in the body, especially when you have a cut or another type of injury. Vitamin K also helps the body to utilize and strengthen our bones. According to Mount Sinai, research has found that people who have higher levels of vitamin K have greater bone density, while low levels of vitamin K have been found in those with osteoporosis. There are other studies suggesting that low levels of vitamin K may put people at greater risk for osteoarthritis. There is increasing evidence that vitamin K may help to prevent fractures in postmenopausal women who are at greater risk for osteoporosis. We also have evidence that vitamin K contributes to bone health in male and female athletes. And this is because vitamin K helps to activate a protein called osteocalcin. Osteocalcin plays a very important role in bone formation and mineralization, and this helps to strengthen bones and prevent fractures. Osteocalcin is the most important protein found in bone after collagen, and it is produced by cells called osteoblasts. Osteocalcin also acts as a hormone to adjust insulin and glucose levels in the body. It increases testosterone, aids in muscle strength, and it also helps with cognitive function. Let's discuss who is more at risk for developing a vitamin K deficiency. Vitamin K deficiency is fairly rare because we can acquire vitamin K through our diets, say through green leafy vegetables, or in many cases, our gut is also able to produce vitamin K. Those who are more at risk for a vitamin K deficiency are usually people who have a low amount of vitamin K in their diet, or they have a malabsorption issue, meaning that they are not able to absorb enough vitamin K from their diet for their body to utilize. This includes individuals who suffer from alcohol abuse, general malnutrition, malabsorption, liver, gallbladder, and biliary diseases, celiac disease, and cystic fibrosis. It's also important to note that those who are already prone to a vitamin K deficiency and are given long-term antibiotics may be at risk for deficiency, and this is because the antibiotics are not selective and they can deplete the very bacteria that are responsible for producing vitamin K in the gut. Those who are on long-term hemodialysis and those who suffer from severe burns are also at a higher risk for vitamin K deficiency. There is also evidence that some patients who have Alzheimer's may be at a higher risk of vitamin K deficiency due to a lower amount of vitamin K in the diet. There is some research that suggests that supplementation with vitamin K in older but healthy adults may help to improve cognitive function. However, caution is warranted because supplementation with vitamin K can interact with medications, and we will speak about this in a moment. So what are the signs that you may be deficient in vitamin K? The daily requirement for vitamin K for women is 90 micrograms a day and 120 micrograms a day for men. Though deficiency is considered to be rare, a vitamin K deficiency may present in the following ways: a prolonged prothrombin time, and this can be measured with a very simple blood test; unusual bleeding, easy bruising, or gums that are bleeding quite frequently. This could also be caused by other things, but it could be a sign of vitamin K deficiency; hemorrhaging, osteopenia, which is a condition where there is lower than normal bone mass or bone density, and even osteoporosis. What type of foods contain vitamin K? Vitamin K1 is mostly found in plants and is our main dietary source of vitamin K, whereas vitamin K2 is found in fermented foods and some meats and cheeses. Foods that contain a significant amount of vitamin K include broccoli, kale, spinach, asparagus, and dark green lettuce. Beef liver, green tea, and turnip greens are also abundant in vitamin K. Chlorophyll is the substance in plants that gives plants their green color and is abundant in vitamin K. Finally, vitamin K can also be found in soybean and canola oil, fortified meal replacement shakes, and the menaquinones can be found in natto, which is a type of fermented soybean, as well as smaller amounts that can be found in meat, cheese, and eggs. It is very important to note that freezing foods can destroy the amount of vitamin K in that food. However, heating or cooking foods does not seem to destroy vitamin K. It really is not difficult to ingest adequate amounts of vitamin K daily. In the video description below, I will give you a chart that shows you the amounts of vitamin K found in different foods. You will see that just half a cup of beets will provide you with 368 micrograms of vitamin K. So this goes back to the importance of maintaining a healthy diet full of whole foods that you can cook. This ensures that you will get enough vitamin K daily. So if you are considering supplementing vitamin K, A question you should be asking is, can vitamin K interact with medications? And the answer is yes. A change in diet that results in excess intake of vitamin K from dietary sources can interact with a group of medications known as oral anticoagulants. In this case, the medication that we are most concerned with is warfarin, otherwise known as Coumadin. Vitamin K supplements should not be taken while on the medication warfarin. However, if you are already on warfarin and taking vitamin K, please do not make any adjustments without talking to your primary care provider first. There are, however, newer medications that are being used with increasing frequency that do not have this type of interaction with vitamin K. Another medication that can interact with vitamin K is the antibiotic family cephalosporins. If a person is given a cephalosporin like cephalexin or keflex or ceferoxime, there is a whole family of these medications, for more than 10 days, this could leave someone who is already prone to deficiency to be deficient in vitamin K. We know that patients who are given antibiotics for longer terms are more prone to deficiency. Another medication that can leave babies more prone to vitamin K deficiency if their mothers are on this medication is called phenytoin, otherwise known as Dilantin. Now, vitamin K does not cross the placenta and it does not cross into breast milk in very high amounts. And mothers who are on this medication are more prone to deficiency in the first place, meaning that their babies will get less vitamin K from the mother. And so this needs to be monitored by a physician. There is another medication that is often used for weight loss, and it is a bile acid sequestrant that we know as orlistat or Xenical. This medication helps to reduce the amount of fat that the body is actually absorbing. In doing this, it also reduces the amount of fat-soluble vitamins, vitamin A, D, E, and K, that the body is able to absorb. So this could leave someone more prone to a deficiency if used over a long period of time. Now, there's a very interesting study that looked at the supplementation of vitamin D and vitamin K versus placebo and cardiovascular health. They looked at whether this type of supplementation could help to prevent the progression of calcification in patients with aortic stenosis. Now, this was a multi-center, double-blind, randomized trial. It was a very high-quality study. This trial looked specifically at men who had evidence of aortic and coronary artery calcification as verified and monitored by CT scan. They looked at whether giving patients either a placebo or vitamin D with vitamin K2 would help to prevent the progression of calcification. The men were divided into two groups and given either placebo or 720 micrograms of menaquinone 7 plus 25 micrograms of vitamin D. These patients were then monitored over a period of 24 months. Though this trial noted that there was no significant difference in the progression rate of calcification in those treated with vitamin D and MK7 versus placebo, they did, however, note that there was a significant reduction in a particular protein known as dephosphorylated uncarboxylated matrix GLA protein in the MK7 plus vitamin D group, this being a biomarker of functional vitamin K status. We do know that high plasma concentrations of this particular protein are a reflection of poor vitamin K status. There is definitely a need for more high quality research on the benefits of vitamin K2 supplementation. Fortunately, for most healthy adults, we know that dietary intake of vitamin K2 is quite easily attainable. Though some vitamin D supplements are already coming with the addition of vitamin K2, it's particularly important to ask your healthcare provider before taking any of these supplements, in particular if you are already taking other medications or supplements that could interact. This will also give you information as to when you should take the medication so you can properly absorb this and get the most benefit from your vitamins and supplements. If you like this video, don't forget to give it a like and subscribe with notifications for future videos. Check out my next video here. Thank you so much for joining me. Take care and stay healthy. Bye-bye.